Hi thinkers, welcome to the microprocessor playlist on thinkxacademy.com. In this section, we are going to cover the program control instructions, which is this section 5. And this is the first tutorial of this section. In the previous section, which is section 4, we have studied data transfer instructions. Now here we are going to study how we can actually change the control or the flow of the program execution and what are the instructions that we are going to study. So first of all, let me give you a formal definition or a very clear explanation of what exactly is a program control instruction. So basically, a program control instruction, which is, I'm just going to write it as PC instruction. And essentially what it does is it directs the flow of a program. Right, so that's what essentially these types of instruction will do. They will direct the flow of program, and this flow will be able to change also. So it will also be able to change the flow. Right, so here I'm just going to write change the flow. Now things will become clear when I will take a very simple example to explain you this. So let's take a very simple example. Let's say if you have studied any programming language like C++, Java, Python, or any other programming language that you have studied, you might have written some programs in it, right? So just consider that we have a very simple program here, right? So I'm just going to draw a box here, and let's say that this simple box represents a program, and I'm just going to assume that this is a C++ program. So let's say that this is a test.c++ file where it contains the lines of code here. So let's assume that these are the lines of code in this program. Now what usually happen is at the runtime, when you are going to run this test.cpp, it is going to go from one line, then it will execute the second line, and then it will execute the next line. So this is actually the flow of the whole execution. So I can also say it that this is actually a execution flow. So you can see that the traditionally, or you can say conventionally, what will happen is the compiler will try to execute the program one by one. So basically each and every line is going to first get stored inside of the memory, which is the main memory, and then one by one each of these lines will be executed. Now in order to change the flow, you might have studied some if else condition, right? So if else is there. So if you introduce if else in this whole code, what you can do is you can actually change the flow, which is the conventional flow, which is from one line to the another. You can actually skip some section by using a if condition, and you can just say that if the condition evaluates to be true, then only you are going to execute or direct the flow here, right? So that's what essentially means the control of the program. So what we are just trying to do is we are changing the traditional flow of the program execution, right? So there are other ways of doing so. We have studied functions also, right? So in C++, whenever you make a function call, what will happen is let's say at this line I make a call to the function execute, and I have defined the function, let's say here. What it is going to do is it is going to change the flow, right? So if these are the lines after this program, it is not going to execute it. It will change the flow to go from here to here, right? Wherever the function is actually defined, it is going to go there, and then it will start executing the code inside of the function. So what essentially we have done here is we have actually changed the flow of the conventional execution. There is one more way. You can see that function will also be able to return something, right? So whenever the function will return something, again the flow will go back to the function call, and it will be replaced by the value that it will return, right? There are some other conditions also. Let's say a system generates an interrupt, right? So basically an interrupt is basically operation where the system is, let's say, waiting for some resources or is actually trying to get some resource, for that it will generate an interrupt. In that cases also, we are actually going to change the program. We will use the program control instructions to actually change the flow of the program execution, right? So what are the ways to do that here? First of all, a change in flow, right? I'm going to write here an important point, that change in flow, which is basically the execution flow, often occurs after a decision is made, right? After some decision is made, the flow will be able to change. So if there is a function call, that's a decision, and that will change the flow. If it is a if else case, there is a test condition which will change the flow, right? So these are the basically decisions made by, let's say, some test or some comparison statements, right? If else or something like that, they are going to actually change the flow of the program, right? Execution. So what are the things, let's sum up all the things that are actually going to make the changes, right? The first is going to be the jumps, right? So jumps are basically when we are trying to jump from one code or one part of the memory to some other part of the memory or something like that. In that case, we are actually changing the flow of execution, and this is important in a lot of cases when we want to execute programs that lie in some other part of the memories, right? So jump statements or jumps instruction is something we will discuss briefly in this section 5.1, and these are very important instructions. There are different types of jump instruction that we will study. Then we have some calls instructions, and then we have returns, which we have already studied here, right? I've already explained this function calls and returns, and then comes the interrupts part. And I've already explained that what an interrupt is, right? So a system will generate an interrupt when it wants some resource. And then we have these types of program control statements, or you can say that program control instructions are capable of doing these four essential things, right? So essentially, this is very important. This section is very important. And here we are going to actually start with the first one, which is the jumps. Now the jump can be of different types, and that's why we have a whole jump group. We call it as a jump group because it actually contains all the different types of jumps that we can perform inside of a program or inside of an instruction set. So different types of jumps are involved in it. So basically, when we are executing the instruction, we already know they are going to get stored inside of the main memory, which is essentially RAM, right? So main memory is basically RAM. And in microprocessors, we have studied that this main memory is actually divided into various segments, data segment, extra segment. We have studied that, right? Code segment, stack segment, all of that. So we will study how jump statements will be able to actually move the flow of the instructions from one segment to the another when we will study a different types of jump groups. So inside of jump group, we have essentially two different classes. The first one is the unconditional jump, right? We have the unconditional jumps. We are going to cover these topics, each of one of them, in detail with the help of instruction examples in 8086 microprocessors. Then we have the conditional jumps, right? So I'm going to write here, we have conditional jumps also. Inside of unconditional jumps, we have three types of jumps. So in the section 5.2, this is 5.1. In the next tutorial, which is 5.2, we are going to study the types of jumps, right? The first type of jump is going to be the short jump. And the short jump is a jump of actually 2 bytes. right? We will study it in detail in the next tutorial, because each type of jump will have a whole example, so a whole tutorial will be dedicated to it. Then in the section, in the tutorial 5.3, we will cover the next type of jump, which is the near jump. And similarly for 5.4, we will cover the far jump. So basically, jump instructions are actually, it starts with JMP. So if you are curious to know that, they are actually, which starts with JMP, and we will study these three types of jumps with the help of examples. So near jump is actually 3 bytes, and far jump is actually 5 bytes. Right, so basically that's all we needed to know about this. It is essential that you know what is the use of program control instructions, because if you don't know the working behind this example, this is basically an example, if you don't know how these types of instructions, what they do, what they essentially work behind the scenes, all of these short jump, near jump, far jump will be basically useless for you, because you won't be able to understand how they're working. So if you know this, this is very important. One important thing that I need to cover here is that jump instructions are there in assembly. We can use JMP to perform some types of jump, but if we want to, let's say, perform if else or function call or something like that, we do have some other identifiers, or you can say some reserved keywords, and we call it as in the relational assembly language. Right, so in the assembly language, we will actually use the traditional jump statement, like we were using the move statement and add statement. Similarly, we have JMP assembly language, but in case of relational assembly language, we have some identifiers that can perform if else, function calls, returns, and all of that stuff, and we will study some of the programs related to that. So in relational assembly language, we have a dot capital IF, then we have dot capital all caps else, and we have some more keywords, like we also have else if, right? So if you're familiar with any programming language, you are actually going to know what these essentially mean. Then we also have a dot while, right, which is basically a iteration statement, and it will be able to perform some iteration. Then we have some more, which is end w, then we have something known as repeat, and we also have the last one, which is until, right? So it is going to repeat until a condition. So these are actually some of the important identifiers which we will be using in the upcoming tutorials of this section, when we will study conditional jumps and unconditional jumps. So basically, that's all for this tutorial. We'll see you in the next tutorial, which is 5.2 short jump. So thanks for watching.